Well, for more on this, we now speak with Maristela Abinohar, the National President of the Filipino Nurses United. Good morning, Ms. Abinohar. Thank you for taking our call.
Good morning, Mike, and to all the viewers and listeners of Rundown Program of ANC.
All right, let me first ask you about this recent development. The Philippine Overseas Employment Administration raising the annual cap of nurses and healthcare workers deployed abroad. That's from 5,000 to 6,500. The POEA is saying 99% of the additional 1,500 slots will go to the nurses. But are these enough? Is the deployment ban, in your view, necessary in the first place?
Mike, as you know, Filipino Nurses United is really against the placing of 5,000 cap because we know very well that by statistics itself, we have enough nurses in the country, and that the very reason why some of our nurses are pushed to leave our country is because of the very low salary and the lack of appreciation that our government is giving to our nurses here. And for us, the 5,000 cap actually is unnecessary, and it is not just for our nurses who have already processed all the documents and necessary papers for having a better work opportunity up outside the country. And the 1,500 additional to the 5,000 cap is also not even enough for the almost 4,000 still pending number of nurses here who are about to leave. No? So instead of adding a very small amount, which most of our nurses now are really not agreeing to, some of them are really desperate already because they feel that our government is not listening carefully, attentively, to their plight. That's why FNU demands that this cap must be lifted totally for the sake of our nurses.
Now, the Philippine government is justifying the deployment ban, saying we need 120,000 nurses. We only have 183,000 nurses compared to our 110 million population. And yet in a previous interview, you said there are 200,000 unemployed nurses in the Philippines. So what's keeping Filipino nurses from working here in the Philippines?
Well, we have plenty of nurses, no? Because the data of our government shows that out of our more than 600,000 produced nurses from the year 2000 to 2019, we have only employed a total of 89,886, both in private and public hospitals and LGU hired primary health care nurses. So we still have enough. But the reason why we have chronic understaffing in most of our health facilities is because it's the salaries and benefits offered are not actually enticing. They are not even enough for our nurses to survive individually. For instance, the salary of our nurses in the private hospital, which is only an average of 8,000 to 10,000 a month, is actually very meager, such that if they have dependents like children or parents to support, this is not even enough. So to encourage them to stay, we have to really change or rather improve our economic situation, our salaries and benefits being offered to our nurses.
Now, how has the experience been of nurses working in the country since the start of the pandemic, both in the private and the public sector? You already touched on this, but I just want to get a sense of what it's like to be working here in the country.
Well, working here in the country is really sacrificing a lot, no? Because aside from the very low salary, they are not even well protected and compensated facing the battle of COVID-19 in the country. For example, the benefits that are under the Bayanihan 2, the active hazard duty pay and the special risk allowance that were promised to them last year, they were delayed. No, they were only able to receive this year, 2021, around April or May, after so much protest, not only in the streets, no, but in media, in public media, so that our government will really release already the allocated budget. And ironically, no, we now have the revelation of our government officials that there is still remaining 18.4 billion unspent for Bayanihan 2. So what happened? No, why is it that they were not able to provide them with the necessary benefits and compensation, when in fact there are still so much budget, no, in their respected agencies, no, government agencies and respective employers.
Right. Let's talk about some of these benefits. For example, the hazard pay. There was this story about a nurse who worked for a government hospital who died due to COVID. Her family expected to get 30,000 pesos after working for 60 days, or that's 500 pesos per day, as the DOH promised. Now, the family only received less than 8,000 pesos. This was in August of last year. Is this still the case for most nurses working in the government hospitals?
Because the active hazard duty... The answer, Sir Mike, is yes. No, because the active hazard duty pay, which is under Bayanihan 2, is only 3,000 per month, and it is prorated. So, meaning if you divide that by 22 days, that's only about 136 pesos a day. It's not even 500. That's the reason why they are really getting very small amount. No, in compared to the tremendous hazards they face, no, when performing their duty in saving the lives of our kababayans. And for the special risk allowance, it's only 5,000 a month, which is also prorated. So if you divide that, that's only in 22 days, that's only 227 per day. Now it's really an insult for our health workers, because
So it's not 500 pesos per day?
No, that was in Bayanihan 2. In Bayanihan 2, there is no special risk allowance, but there is active hazard duty pay, which is 500 pesos per day, no? For every actual duty day. That's in Bayanihan 1. When it was Bayanihan 2, the active hazard duty pay was 3,000 per month. And you divide that by 22 days, that's not even 500. That's only 136 pesos, something like that.
Wow. And what about the 1 billion pesos provided under Bayanihan Act 2 for every death of a health worker? Has that been given? And how is the mortality rate of nurses so far?
Oh, well, it's 1 million, no? It's 1 million for every health worker who died of COVID. And there is this 100,000 for a severe and critical case of our health workers with COVID, and 15,000 for mild and moderate case of COVID. But all these compensations were released late, no, very late. The process, the approval process, and the preparation of checks were very slow, and it needs a lot of lobbying from the health workers. As of May this year, we have more than 18,000 health workers infected with COVID. And according to the DOH, there were 94 recorded deaths of health workers due to COVID-19. But our very own members in Filipino Nurses United claimed that they had difficulty really in processing their papers, because after, for example, if they had moderate COVID, after getting well from this particular disease, they have to process it by themselves. They have to go from their employer to the Department of Health, and they don't have the necessary support expected from their employers to make it more easier for them to access the benefits. That's the reason why sometimes it took really several months because, well, you know, when they are on quarantine because they have COVID or if they are in the stage of being confined in a particular hospital, no work, no pay. So as soon as they get well, they have to go back to work and getting some time to process all these papers is really a big headache for our health workers.
Now, I can just imagine the other allowances and benefits because there are reports that the budget department is still processing hazard and special risk allowances from January to June this year. Is that really the case?
True. That's the case. Because we're even lobbying that this be sustained, no? For this year, because in Bayanihan too, it's only until December 19, 2020. But we are lobbying that since COVID is still here and it's increasing from time to time, it's not even resolved yet. Therefore, our health workers deserve to have the sustained compensation and benefits from the Bayanihan 2 package.
All right. Now, let's talk about protection for the health workers and for nurses. There were reports about the lack of personal protective equipment for medical personnel early on in the pandemic. Is this still the case?
Yes, Mike, it is still the case. In fact, in some of our tertiary COVID referral hospitals, they are only they were advised recently that they use only one set of personal protective equipment, and that some of them must be washed in their respective homes so that they can repeat the use of these PPEs. Some are even saying that a surgical mask is allowed this time, no, even without the face mask. So these are some contradicting and confusing protocols to our health workers. And we feel that this is all because they wanted to limit the expenditures for personal protective equipment. That's why we cannot avoid that our health workers take this out of their pocket. No? They buy their own personal protective equipment just to guarantee them, just to guarantee their protection while performing their duties in the hospital.
Now, we've talked about delayed hazard pay and other allowances, plus the deployment ban preventing nurses from seeking greener pastures abroad. And now the Philippine government is about to lose 18 billion unused funds under the Bayanihan Act 2 come June 30th. You've touched on this earlier, but I just want to get your thoughts on this.
Well, since they have admitted already that there is still 18.4 billion unspent, the Filipino Nurses United strongly recommends that this 18.4 billion be utilized for two topmost priorities in implementing Bayanihan 2. And first is to sustain Bayanihan 2 benefits and compensation for all our health workers, both those working in public and private hospitals, and including our contractual health workers. We consider them as the most essential workforce and the key to saving and preventing the lives of our people in this COVID pandemic. So we made some mathematical estimate of our recommendation. And we know for a fact that in the health human resources data of the Department of Health, there is around 89,886 nurses, both public and private, but in total we have 185,908 other health workers like doctors, midwives, rad tech, medical technologies, and other support health workers. So we want all of them to be provided with special risk allowance and active hazard duty pay, as well as this compensation for those who get infected, whether it's mild, moderate, severe, critical, and most especially for our colleagues who die in the midst of the battle for pandemic. Second, Mike, we recommend that since many of our hospitals have reported reaching or almost reaching their breaking point in terms of being severely understaffed. That's why some of their wards are closing, some of their wards are merged, or they simply cannot accept already additional patients in their respective hospitals. Our recommendation is still to pursue the mass hiring of additional nurses, both public and private hospital. Mike, we have 1,700 COVID referral hospitals in the country. And in our estimate, if we provide at least 200 nurses for the 100 hospitals, which is almost 6% of the total COVID referral, we can have allocate 8.5 billion pesos for their salaries, at least for 1 year, from January to December this year, so that there will be continuity of service to our kababayans in this time of pandemic. And we can also be assured of enough contact tracers and enough public health nurses, for instance, who can educate our people for the prevention and protection against COVID-19.
Well, we certainly hope for the best. And thank you for your service to our country. Ms. Maristela Abinoha, President of the Filipino Nurses United.
Thank you so much, Mike.